Tari adalah gerak tubuh yang secara berirama, senada dengan alunan musik yang dilakukan di tempat dan waktu tertentu, untuk keperluan pergaulan mengungkapkan perasaan, maksud, dan pikiran. Mudra adalah simbol tangan simbolik yang digunakan dalam ikonografi Hindu dan Buddha, seni persembahan dan amalan rohani, termasuk yoga, tarian, drama, dan tantra. Tarian mudra ini dikembangkan oleh salah satu mahasiswi Sekolah Tinggi Agama Buddha Negeri Sriwijaya, yang mana tarian ini dikembangkan menjadi tarian yang indah. Tata rias yang digunakan dalam tari mudra adalah tata rias khas cantik. Busana yang baik bukan hanya sekedar berguna sebagai penutup tubuh penari, tetapi merupakan suatu penunjang keindahan ekspresi, serta secara simbolik bisa menggambarkan perwatakan atau karakter tari yang dibawakan oleh penari. Terdapat 5 gerakan mudra. Yang pertama, mudra dharma cakra, artinya memutar roda dharma atau hukum. Posisi tangan mudra ini melibatkan kedua tangan. Tangan kanan dipegang pada tingkat dada dengan telapak tangan menghadap keluar. Lingkaran mistik dibentuk dengan menggabungkan ujung jari telunjuk dan ibu jari. Tangan kiri dibalik ke dalam dan jari telunjuk dan ibu jari dari tangan ini bergabung untuk menyentuh lingkaran tangan kanan. Yang kedua, gerakan mudra bumi sparsa. Ini adalah salah satu mudra paling umum ditemukan di patung-patung Buddha, artinya menyentuh bumi. Posisi tangan ditampilkan dalam posisi duduk meditasi saja. Di mudra ini, tangan kanan menunjuk ke arah bumi, tergantung di atas lutut, telapak tangan ke dalam. Tangan kiri di mudra ini bersandar di pangkuan, telapak tangan kanan tegak. Yang ketiga, gerakan mudra warada, makna amal belas kasihan atau mengabulkan keinginan. Posisi tangan, lengan kanan diperpanjang dalam posisi alami sepanjang jalan ke bawah, dengan telapak tangan terbuka menghadap keluar ke arah penonton. Mudra ini menandakan 5 kesempurnaan, yaitu kemurahan hati, moralitas, kesabaran, upaya, dan konsentrasi meditasi. Melalui 5 jari yang diperpanjang, mudra ini ditemukan dalam kombinasi dengan mudra lain seperti abaya. Gerakan mudra selanjutnya yaitu mudra dhyana, artinya meditasi, juga disebut samadhi atau yoga mudra. Posisi tangan, gerakan ini juga aneh dengan posisi duduk saja. Di mudra ini kedua tangan di pangkuan, dengan bagian belakang tangan kanan bersandar di telapak tangan kiri dengan jari diperpanjang. Gerakan ini telah digunakan oleh yogis untuk meditasi dan konsentrasi. Ini juga menandakan pencapaian kesempurnaan rohani. Mudra ini digunakan oleh Buddha selama meditasi terakhir di bawah pohon bodhi. Gerakan mudra selanjutnya adalah mudra abaya, artinya fearlessness. Posisi tangan di mudra ini, tangan kanan umumnya dinaikkan ketinggian bahu dengan lengan ditekuk, telapak tangan kanan menghadap keluar dan jari-jari tegak dan bergabung. Tangan kiri menggantung ke bawah di posisi tubuh. Gerakan ini ditunjukkan oleh Buddha segera setelah mencapai pencerahan. Ini melambangkan kekuatan dan keamanan batin. Ini adalah isyarat yang menanamkan rasa tak kenal takut kepada orang lain juga.
layak menjadi sekolah tinggi, maka segera ubah status, buka prodi dan segera usul menjadi institut. Yang penting sudah ada prodi.
Bapak Ibu peserta special lecture, kita akan mulai kurang lebih di waktu sana kira-kira 7 menit lagi sesuai dengan schedule. Sementara itu mungkin bisa melihat profil dari Sekolah Tinggi Agama Buddha Negeri Sriwijaya Tangerang Banten, dan terima kasih sudah bergabung bersama komunitas Sriwijaya Academic Circle Community yang nantinya juga akan menyelenggarakan berbagai macam discourse akademik dari berbagai macam praktisi, cendikia, profesor, doktor, dan juga tokoh-tokoh agama Buddha, dan juga tokoh akademik dari berbagai macam belahan dunia. Terima kasih. Pak Sugi mungkin bisa sambil dijelaskan ya visi dan misi Stabern Sriwijaya, soalnya nggak ada audionya. Final check suara saya, Pak Waluyo, bisa terdengar?
Bisa, Sir. Ada putus-putus sedikit tadi.
Sekarang bagaimana?
Ya, sekarang lebih baik.
Baik, Bapak-Ibu, peserta yang sudah tergabung di dalam platform Zoom ini, kita akan mulai sesuai dengan waktu yang ditentukan, yaitu pukul 15.30 atau 3:30 waktu Indonesia bagian Barat. Kemudian ada perbedaan waktu, kita lebih cepat 1,5 jam dari daerah Maharashtra State di India. Jadi saya dapat kabar dari Profesor Sandip sedang bersiap-siap device-nya. Mohon menunggu ya. mohon dikabari kalau speaker sudah masuk di dalam platform Zoom,
Pak Ol. Ya, baik, sir. Belum sepertinya.
Jadi, sekali lagi, Pak Sugi, ada yang request masuk ke saya. Monggo, Pak Sugi.
Masuk aja pilihan. Tadi aku lift nih kan ya. Lift. Kapan sih bacanya?
Nggak mau bisa ya, dari bisa.
Saya mohon maaf tidak bisa memakai virtual background ini karena di kampus malah tidak bisa dipakai. Baik, sebelum kita mulai karena belum ada pembicara, kami mohon untuk Pak Ketua STBN Sriwijaya untuk memberikan sedikit introduction atau pengantar perihal kegiatan-kegiatan yang kita lakukan dari bulan Juli awal ini sampai dengan akhir Agustus nanti yang berkaitan dengan peningkatan mutu akademik, international engagement, dan juga aktivitas dari kelembagaan STBN Sriwijaya. Kepada Pak Dr. Sapardi.
Oke, terima kasih. Sugiyonto Namo Buddhaya. Salam sejahtera untuk kita semuanya. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, tentu apresiasi yang pertama, semoga kegiatan ini lancar. Karena apapun ini adalah sebuah perubahan dan perubahan harus dilakukan. Saya sangat bangga ketika rekan-rekan semua, khususnya keluarga besar STBN Sriwijaya, baik para dosen maupun pegawai bersatu padu, untuk menciptakan sebuah perubahan dalam rangka membangun budaya dhamma. Dan ini harus dilanjutkan terus dan terus menerus. Jangan sampai terhenti, ya. Karena kita punya kesempatan yang luar biasa, sangat luar biasa. Kenapa? Karena selama ini kita masih terkungkung seperti katak dalam tempurung. Dan saya bangga kita bisa menjadi motor penggerak ya, dari semua perubahan. Dan saya yakin semua para dosen, ya, khususnya terkait dengan proses di dalam perkuliahan, ya, pengertian maupun penelitian itu bisa melakukan bersama, yang ditunjang juga oleh teman kita dari para pegawai semuanya. Terkait dengan program dalam satu bulan ke depan ini, tentu adalah program-program yang saya pikir sangat cerdas ya, sangat cerdas. Saya akui ini sangat cerdas, kenapa? Ya kebetulan anak-anak kita kemarin dari BEM saja, saya melihat ada perubahan yang sangat signifikan ya, satu perubahan yang tadi bisa ditampilkan itu ada indikasi bahwa Sriwijaya sudah siap bergerak menuju, kalau perlu langsung tancap gas untuk go internasional. Nah, saya percaya dimotori oleh Mr. Edi Rama, kemudian oleh teman-teman yang lain, ada Pak Waluyo, Pak Sugianto, Pak Asan, dan rekan-rekan yang lain yang tidak disebutkan satu persatu, semuanya bisa. Apalagi dengan nanti ya, Ini akan menjadi menggaung di dalam mana bagaimana kita mengembangkan peluang itu. Saya minta tolong rekan-rekan coba sih. Karena kalau satu sudah dilakukan dengan ya, yang kedua dengan India, Prof. Sandep, saya percaya bahwa untuk mengkomunikasikan saja awalnya pasti tidak mudah, tetapi trik-trik yang dibangun pasti sudah ada lah ya. Kalau kita sebagai dosen pasti tahu trik-trik yang dibangun ya, itulah bahwa setiap kemampuan kalau difokuskan kepada satu tujuan besar dikomunikasikan, saya yakin nanti akan menghasilkan sesuatu yang besar. Dan khususnya teman-teman di Sriwijaya, bahwa tidak ada sesuatu yang paling tinggi, paling besar di Sriwijaya. Ini adalah kerja tim. Ini adalah kerja kelompok. Ya. Mudah-mudahan nanti Sriwijaya akan di depan dan terdepan akan menjadi contoh dari perguruan tinggi agama Buddha yang lain. Ya. Saya yakin kita ini bisa. Kenapa? SDM kita sudah tersedia, sarana prasarana sudah tersedia. Memang saya menyadari betul bahwa dalam situasi begini dari sisi finansial memang kita harus ikat pinggang, tidak apa-apa, tapi kita harus bisa mencari solusi jalan keluarnya. Saya yakin ini yang menjadi satu harapan bahwa silakan teman-teman berekspresi dengan sebaik-baiknya ya. Silakan dedikasikan untuk kemajuan Sriwijaya dan semua harus mendapatkan kebahagiaan yang sama. Jadi tidak ada satupun yang tertinggal. Saya berharap seperti itu. Karena kita memang harus seperti itu. Keadilan harus seperti itu. Dan mohon maaf dalam satu minggu ini saya tidak bisa hadir karena situasi saya sendiri sedang tidak enak badan dan baru hari inilah saya merasakan makan ada rasanya ya. Kalau kemarin-kemarin cukup tinggi panas saya, jadi terima kasih ya. Doa rekan-rekan, mudah-mudahan nanti Senin depan kita sudah bisa go lagi. Saya kira itu penekanan saya, selamat melaksanakan, selamat berkarya, terus berjuang, dan jangan berhenti, maju terus untuk kemajuan Buddha Dhamma. Terima kasih, Sugiyoto Namo Buddhaya.
Namo Buddhaya. Thank you, Mr. Dr. Sapardi, SAG M. Hum, as Chairman of Sriwijaya State Buddhist College of Tangerang, Banten. As we can see now on the screen, Professor Sandip Nagarale. Hello, Prof. Can you hear my voice? Hello, Professor Sandip. Can you hear my voice? Pak Waluyo, is he already here?
Ah, yeah. So, yes, sir.
Hello.
Ah, yes, sir. Namaste.
Yeah, namaste. Namaste.
Namo Buddhaya.
First of all, I would like to say thank you. Namo Buddhaya. First of all, I would like to deliver our gratitude and appreciation so that you can come to our special lecture series. With the title Humanistic Values in Buddhism Under Contemporary International Law. It is very interesting topic and it is honor for us in Indonesia and the whole members of Sriwijaya State Buddhist College of Tangerang, Banten and every people who already been here in the platform of Zoom. If I'm not mistaken, I can see around 100 people here will listen to your thoughts and also your share about humanistic values and its relevance with international law. We do hope that audience will listen carefully to your presentation and your talks, and at the end of the talk, there will a chance for them to ask, making comments, clarify, or add something on your presentations. So, Professor Sandip, the time is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, my dear learned friend, Dr. E.D. Ramavijayaputra. The other members of organizing committee, lecturers and dear students, it's honor for me to be here to interact with you on the important topic of humanistic views in Buddhism and its relevance under contemporary international law. Sir, may I share the screen?
Yes, the host already make you as a co-host, so you just put the share screen button and we can see directly your PowerPoint presentation. Thank you very much.
So as stated by dear friend, Dr. Edi, that topic of today is humanistic views in Buddhism and its relevance under contemporary international law. Friends, when we talk about Buddhism, what we call today as a religion is not a religion to be followed by particular idealistic people. This particular name of Buddhism is given by his disciples or followers after Buddha. What Buddha gave more than 2,500 years ago is a pure Dhamma. He called his teachings as Dhamma, and which is in the nature of philosophy. And his all teachings were based on the law of nature. We call him as a scientist also, that he studied the human behavior, psychology of the human mind, and thereafter come up with his ideology, his philosophy, which is in the interest of common man. So principles given by Buddha are universal one and can be tested everywhere. It is equally applicable in India, similarly in Indonesia and USA. So it is purely scientific religion. You can say it's a universal nature. The important thing is that Buddha denied all evil practices of his time and urges people to follow his principles. At that time, at the time of Buddha, there were four Varnas in India, in Indian continent, and only some people were allowed to do a particular work. And therefore, evil practices were also in existence at that time, but he denied all that traditional methods, traditional theories and practices, and come up with his new Dhamma. His theory is based on cause and effect theory. Whatever we are doing,
I'm sorry to get you interrupted, Professor Sandeep.
Yes, sir.
We could not see your PowerPoint presentation. Would you please share the screen button? And then first,
I have shared.
I think you need to open the PowerPoint first in your laptop, and then after that, please press the share button in the Zoom, and then we can see it directly, because
let
we only
check.
See. Yes, okay.
Let me check it.
Sorry, yeah.
No
yes,
problem.
Right. Please open that SCN file. Can you open that SCN file, Indonesia, in your laptop? Hello, Professor.
Ah, yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, double click. All right.
No, sir. Okay.
It's still not display, yeah? I don't know why. Can somebody, Pak Waluyo, do you have any solution for that? or can you send the file to us, Professor?
Yeah, dikirim ke Mr. Eddie dulu.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Just a minute.
Yes.
Let me try once.
Okay, right. Yeah, sorry, ladies and gentlemen, the presentation of Professor Sadib is very interesting, and it will be more interesting if we can see the PowerPoint presentation. Yeah? So please wait a moment so that we can see the display of the PowerPoint. So we already hear the introduction from Professor Sandeep, who says that the teaching of the Buddha is based on universal principles. Yeah, so it is also applicable in education, in philosophy, in science, and also in law. So the Buddha give us universal principles, not just the followed by Buddhism, not just followed by Buddhist people. No, but it is universal. So that's why in the introduction, Professor Sandeep say that Buddhist teaching is based on the universal principles that we know as Dhamma. Nah, itu jadi introduction-nya di depan.
Just a minute. All right. Sir, can you send me your email, please?
Email, all right. I will text you on the WhatsApp. Yes, already there in your WhatsApp, okay. My email, and I will pass to Pak Waluyo so that he can help you to display the PowerPoint. Pak Waluyo, would you please stand by on your WhatsApp so I can send you the file?
Just a minute. Right. Sorry for disturbance.
No problem, Professor. This is only to make us clear. Just let me know anytime the file sent to my email, and I will pass it to Pak Waluyo.
Kindly check it, sir.
Sure, I'll check it. Okay, it's here. Okay, it's here. Now I'll send directly to Pak Waluyo so he can display it. This is very interesting. Okay, hold up. Why I cannot? Pak Waluyo, coba buka email sadar setiap saat, Pak. Ini saya nggak bisa. Pak Wal?
Ya, baik. Sebentar ya.
Ya, okay.
Ya, sudah masuk, sir.
Oke.
Right. Download dulu ya.
Sir, am I visible to you?
Yes. You are visible. I can see your... Where are you right now, Professor? At home or at campus?
Yes, sir. At home.
At home. Wow.
Yes.
How is it situation there? Okay, before we go to presentation, how is the COVID situation there in India?
Now it's better, but there is fear about third wave, and therefore there is lockdown, and colleges and schools are still closed.
Closed, yeah.
But other works like examination and other relevant work are going on in the college. As a staff, we are going to college.
Yes, we have the same situation. Even now, it's getting worse in Indonesia. Yes, it's already displayed. Please continue, Professor.
Yes. But I'm not getting it.
Pak Wal, kenapa dia buram begitu ya, Pak Wal?
But it's not visible to me.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, tapi di sini sudah siap, sudah kelihatan.
Okay. Maybe the signal ya.
Saya kirim ke Pak Sugi mungkin bisa share bantu.
Okay, maybe.
Because yang sinyalnya bagus.
Pak Sugi ya.
Yang sinyalnya bagus.
Pak Rahmat, Pak Rahmat.
Okay. Saya kirim ya Pak ya.
Sorry ladies and gentlemen, we need to make sure the PowerPoint well displayed. So hold up, we still have much time to go. Yeah, as I can see, the signal in Pak Waluyo is red color, which indicates he is on a very, very bad signal spot.
Oh.
My colleague Pak Waluyo, Mr. Waluyo, your signal is quite good. I can see from the indicators. It's good, Professor Sandip. Wait a moment. We need to pass the file once again to our friends, and he will help you to display it. Hold on.
Yeah, sudah Pak Rahmat, mohon dicek.
So may I continue, sir?
Wait a moment. Another 1 minute. Wait a minute. Did you get the file, Pak Rahmat?
Sudah, tapi belum jadi bisa apa share. Share-nya dulu, Pak Wal. Izinkan.
Ya, yeah, sudah. Oh. Silakan. Sudah, ya.
Okay, looks good. Keep going, Professor Sandip.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Right. So, as we discussed that more than 2,500 years ago, what Buddha teaches us is a universal one, and you can taste it everywhere. It is having similar implication apart from your boundaries. So it is depend upon cause and effect theory. But the important thing of his teaching is that he never compels people to follow his ideals or philosophy blindly. Whatever he, through his sermons, gave teaching, but he never claimed that whatever he said is absolutely correct. On the contrary, what he said that he call upon people to come forward and make scrutiny of his teachings. Then there is one gatha which says that Swakhato Bhagavata Dhammo Sanditiko Akaliko Ehi Pasiko Openeiko Pachatam Veditabbo Vinuiti. It means the Dhamma is well spoken by the Bhagwan, visible here and now. It is timeless, inviting one to come and see, leading forward and to be experienced by the wise for themselves. Means as a few people or some, you can say, those who give idea of religion or ideology, they claim that whatever they said, it is 100% true and there should not be any correction in future also. But on the contrary, what Buddha says, that whatever I delivered to you, whatever principles I explained to you, is not static one. It may change according to time and situation. But fortunately, such time has not come yet. And the same principle are equally applicable in present era also. Buddha also stated that, do not believe in traditions, as it is said by someone, or it is written in the holy books, or it is mentioned at any other place. So what he said that, do not believe in traditions, but experience the truth by your own. That much liberty was given by Buddha to make scrutiny of his ideas, to his principles, and therefore it is a universal one and can be scrutinized at any time. At the beginning, I would like to give idea of these four noble truths and Panchasil and Eightfold Path, because these are the very key principles of Buddhism, and thereafter we will discuss about its relevance. So the four noble truths given by Buddha is, life inevitably involves suffering. What is dukkha satya? There is dukkha, sorrow in life. And second principle says that samudaya satya, suffering originates in desires. Third one is, suffering will cease if all desires cease. It is possible to cease all the suffering. And he also gave the way to cease suffering, that is, cease of desire is possible by engaging in the noble eightfold path. Now, the another important principles of Buddhism are five precepts. This is the precept. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible. But please say that we need to move the slide into accordingly to your speech. As you can see now, the slide. If you already finished with the slide, just say next, and my staff will okay, next slide. Okay, right.
So, five precepts which given by Buddha, we call it as Panchasila. These principles also very much relevant so far as the law is concerned. These five precepts, it is given to the people, to the followers. It is a pledge which is to be taken by people themselves. It is my duty to take the pledge and follow in daily routine and act accordingly. So what are these five precepts? First one is to abstain from taking life. So killing is prohibited. To abstain from taking what is not given. So stealing is prohibited. To abstain from sensuous misconduct, false speech, etc. And to abstain from false speech, and to abstain from toxicants as tending to cloud the mind. So if you correlate these five precepts in present world legal order also, maybe in your country also, the penal code speaks about these things. All these things are punishable offenses. In India also, we have Indian Penal Code. If there is stealing or killing, then these are offenses and subject to punishment. So everywhere, these we considered as evil things, and therefore, which we must consider that not to do all these things, and on the contrary, take positive view in respect of five precepts. Next one.
Next one or which one?
Yes, next one, sir.
Next one. Okay, next one, Pak Rahmat. Next one.
There are, now Eightfold Path.
Eightfold Path. Next.
All students, all are students from Buddhist college. So you are all aware about the right views, right aspiration, right speech, right conduct, right livelihood, right efforts, right mindfulness, and right contemplation. So if you follow in our everyday life these all right things in right perspective, then it will help us, as this is the fourth one, that you can avoid suffering. But how you can avoid suffering? So if you follow this eightfold path given by Buddha, then we can avoid suffering in our life. Next one. Next slide, sir. Now, the humanistic views in Buddhism. Buddhist doctrine is that of impermanence. What Buddha said, everything changes. And nothing is permanent. All things are temporary. So that is the basic, again, doctrine of Buddha. It means when we realize that nothing is permanent, then it becomes easier for us to lead a daily life. There is one story when one person came to Buddha and asked about the sorrow in his life. So Buddha said that you considered that tomorrow is the last day of your life. So when there is a idea in our mind that tomorrow will be the last day of our life, then see how there are changes to place in our daily routine. Or we can think that tomorrow we are going to die. So what to do today? So that time we'll never try to quarrel with others. We never try to do evil things, or we try to speak with love or give treatment of love. So therefore that that principle of impermanence also very much important if you want to lead a good life. Friends, in India, Dr. Ambedkar, who was instrumental in reviving Buddhism in India, we also call him as a father of the Constitution of India, and the world-renowned leader, what he said, he summarized the Buddhist humanistic views in few words. According to Dr. Ambedkar, Buddha Dhamma stand for social welfare. That is Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya. Means welfare of the maximum people. That is the social welfare of people. Then the cornerstone of the edifice of Buddha, Buddha Dhamma, is Sila. He called it morality. And that morality replaces the God. Because there is no any supernatural person or power, or there is need of fear of that particular God or any such kind of personality. What is important in Buddhism is karma. So the way we lead our life, we will get the result of that. So Dr. Ambedkar said that according to Buddha, sila is important, morality is important in life. Thereafter, he said that liberty, equality, fraternity, equity, justice, samta, pragya, karuna, and maitri are the pillars on which the superstructure of Buddha Dhamma is built. You know, you already know it, that in India, Indonesian constitution also, there is a concept of social welfare. That there should be social justice to the people, social welfare of the people. So here in India also, and you will find references in other countries that the state always strive to promote the social welfare of the people. That was said by Buddha more than 2,500 years ago, that Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya, the welfare of the maximum people. Then the Buddha was against the caste system and inequality of the society. I will discuss later on, just giving you an idea, that caste system in India at that time, caste system was prevalent, and therefore he opposed it. That how can there will be discrimination among people? As there is one theory, we said all men are born free and equal. So when all men are born free and equal, then why there is caste system? Why there is discrimination? Why there is inequality? So Buddha was in favor of equality and denies that discrimination in the society. He gave admission into his Sangha to the so-called lower caste people also. As he maintained equality, and therefore he called upon all the people, those who were interested in Sangha, and also gave admission. Not only that, he also maintained equality among Sangha members. That it was also the duty of Sangha members to follow the equality in Sangha. Moreover, Buddha also supported equality among men and women. And therefore, by imposing certain rules, he opens the doors of Sangha to female members also to become astri or monk. So earlier in India, and later on it also spread in Asia and other countries, earlier women were not allowed in Sangha. But as he maintained, as he prescribed, as he supported for the principle of equality, and therefore he treated men, women equally, and also gave entry to women in Sangha as like men. So these are some humanistic views of Buddhism, basic views. Next one. Next slide, please. Then next. Humanistic view in Buddhism and its relevance. Now we will correlate that humanistic views of Buddhism with law, specifically international law. As I just stated that Buddhism prescribed for the philosophy that all men are born free and equal in dignity. Means the principle of equality was promoted by Lord Buddha. Then how that equality is very much important to lead a good life, good human life. It is a basic human right. Equality, liberty, fraternity, these are the basic human values need to be followed in our everyday life. Without all these values, it will be difficult for human being to make development in his life. And therefore, that equality principle, if you read the charter, UN Charter of 1945, you know, after two world wars, again, there was a fear in the mind of world leaders that what will be the fate of this earth if third world war happened. And therefore, as the UN Charter itself says, that we have witnessed the two world wars and its devastating effect on the human being and the environment also. And therefore, to save the succeeding generation from the scourge of war, we the people of the United Nations, and therefore preamble determined saying that to affirm faith in fundamental human rights. So in the preamble itself, it affirm the faith in fundamental human rights, and human rights includes several other rights which are important for development of human beings. Moreover, there is dignity and worth of human person in the equal rights of men and women. See, that charter also contains specific provision in respect of the equal rights of men and women. Means though this UN charter is meant for state parties, it is meant for state parties. It is applicable to the states, applicable to the Indonesia, India, USA, China, Japan, Germany. But before that, the rights of individual person is considered in the charter, and the fundamental human rights and the equal rights of men and women also protected in the charter. So the principle of equality, which was prescribed by Buddha, we see its reflection in the UN Charter. Thereafter, there is UDHR, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948. Article 1 says that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience, and should act towards one another in spirit of brotherhood. So if I see the beautiful lines. And the important thing about UDHR is that this Universal Declaration of Human Rights, when the United Nations decided to frame this declaration on human rights, but before that, they decided to study the all religions of this world. So the values of Buddhism, values of Islam, values of Christianity and other religions also, they were studied, discussed and incorporated into UDHR deliberately. So we find reflections of religious values in Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And as Buddhism itself promote equality, liberty, fraternity in Buddha Dhamma, we find its reflection in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Again, there is one important thing about this declaration is that it is Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's a declaration. It's not a covenant. So far as the covenants are concerned, covenants, conventions, these are binding on the state parties, binding on the signatories. But so far as the declaration is concerned, it is just for guidelines for the states. It is not binding. The provisions which are given, 30 articles are there. If any state denied to follow that provisions of UDHR, then there is no problem as such. But the provisions of UDHR, as it relates to the human rights of persons, most of the state considered the provisions of UDHR as part of their own municipal law. In India also, the Honorable Apex Court, the Honorable Supreme Court of India, in number of judgments, takes the help of UDHR, implement that provision through the judgment. I hope in Indonesia also, the court is taking cognizance. Many countries, they are taking cognizance because these countries considered the principles given under UDHR as part of their own municipal law. And therefore, though it is not binding, many states followed it positively. Friends, then it comes the ICCPR, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights of 1966. It is about civil and political rights to the people. It is binding on states. And Article 3 of that ICCPR says that the right to equality between men and women in the enjoyment of their civil and political rights. In Indian Indonesian constitution also, there is provision in respect of protection of civil and political rights of the people. In India also and other countries also, you will find that states are protecting the civil and political rights of its citizens. So through ICCPR, as it's a binding document, and now it is also binding on the state, those who are signatory, to implement that right to equality between men and women. Friends, in many countries, maybe the earlier generation is aware about it, that at the beginning, women were not provided with right to vote. But in ICCPR, you will find that right to vote is considered as important right as like men. So the status of women is considered as important as like or at par with men under that International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights 1966. There are other provisions also under ICCPR Article 14, 26 and other articles. I think your Article 27 of Indonesian Constitution also speaks about equality. So there is also International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights of 1966. The Article 3 again stated that it ensures the equal rights of men and women to enjoy all rights, that is economic, social and cultural. What was protected, promoted by Buddha in his lifetime through his sermons, that we find reflection of all his equality thoughts in these documents. And all these principles are humanistic because without these principles, it becomes very difficult to lead a human life. Friends, then it comes the CEDAW Convention, Convention on the All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, 1979. The General Assembly of the United Nations adopted it in the year 1979. That CEDAW convention, it sets up an agenda for national action to end discrimination against women. Everywhere in the world, women were they were being discriminated. And therefore, to uphold the rights of women, to give rights to the men, like men, the provisions are inserted in CEDAW, and accordingly, through CEDAW convention, the rights of women are being protected everywhere in the world. Friends, next slide, please. Friends, then it comes the liberty. But Buddha stated that the liberty is a fundamental requirement for human dignity, both liberty of thought and of action. Liberty were given to disciples to make scrutiny of his doctrines. We already discussed that he gave liberty to his disciples. They were allowed to make scrutiny, whatever said by him. So liberty is the important factor to lead a good life as a human being. In modern democratic nations, liberty is a fundamental principle. In every state, in every country, we'll find that liberty is promoted, respected. So far as the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights is concerned, Article 9, the right to liberty and security of person is given. Article 12 is also given the right to liberty and freedom of movement. Then in International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights also, there are many provisions in respect of liberty to enjoy the economic, social and cultural rights. Similarly, under UDHR, Article 3 says that everyone has the right to life, liberty and security of person. So these all international instruments speaks about liberty. But again, important thing is that if you consider liberty as a separate entity, then you will not get its importance. It is important to correlate it with equality and fraternity. So if you give only importance to liberty, it is not suffice. So the trinity of equality, liberty, and fraternity read together, implement together, then only it become helpful to lead a good life. So that is the important humanistic views, according to me, given in the Buddhist philosophy. Next slide, please. Then it comes the fraternity. What is meant by fraternity? So the great, according to Buddhist belief, the great compassion is one of the important qualities of the Buddha, and it forms the basis of all perfections, that is paramita, that everyone needs to complete 10 paramitas. So compassion is important element in it, and compassion for all human beings and living beings. Compassion not only for human beings only, but all living beings, what we call as maitri. Karuna is limited to human beings. I already stated that karuna and maitri, that karuna is in respect of love for human beings, compassion for human beings. But maitri is more than that. It is love for all living beings or all living creatures or nature. So it is having the widest meaning, maitri. So that compassion is important when we talk about fraternity. Then if there is hatred in our mind, how it is possible for us to have compassion in our mind? At the same time, there will not be love and compassion in mind. And therefore, it is beneficial to establish fraternity, brotherhood, if we have compassion in our mind. When we have compassion in our mind, there is no question of enmity with others. So once Venerable Ananda said to Lord Buddha that is half of the holy life, blessed one, admirable friendship, admirable companionship, admirable comrader. But then the Buddha replied that it is not the half of the holy life. What Buddha said? Buddha replied, don't say that, Ananda, don't say that. Admirable friendship, admirable companionship, and admirable comrader is actually the whole of the holy life. So that much importance was given by Buddha to the friendship, to the companionship, and to the comrader. So that fraternity is important. And this equality, liberty, and fraternity, this is the trinity which we need to apply in our life. According to Buddhist belief, according to Buddhist humanistic views. So these equality, liberty, and fraternity are important. Again, the UN Charter speaks about fraternity, that what Preamble said, that to practice tolerance and live together in peace with one another as good neighbors. So unless we having fraternity or compassion in our mind about our neighbors, how can we maintain good relationship with our neighbors? So in Ten Commandments also, it is given in Christianity that to make good relations with your neighbors. So Charter also speaks about that good relationship. Again, Charter said that in its purpose to develop friendly relations among nations based on respect for the principle of equal rights and self-determination of people. So it is for nations to maintain respect among people. Next, please. The important humanistic view, next one is ahimsa or non-violence. The ahimsa taught by Buddha was fundamental, but it was not absolute. In entire teaching of Buddha, you will find the importance of ahimsa or non-violence. It is the base. The Tathagata believes that he who deserves punishment must be punished, and he who is worthy of favor must be favored. So, though it is necessary in our everyday life to abide by the principle of ahimsa or non-violence, but at the same time, if there is any person who committed any wrongful act and deserve punishment, then that person must be punished. And if any person committing good things, then he must be honored for that. So in the present day context also, law of the states enumerated provisions for the guilty. Even Charter of the United Nations contains provisions for stringent action against the erring states. Moreover, the UN Charter in its purpose stated that to maintain international peace and security, as the Charter itself, the primary object is to maintain international peace and security. So when we can maintain international peace and security, if there is violence in your locality, in your province, in your state, or between two states, if there is fight, if there is disturbance, then how it is possible to maintain peace? And therefore, to avoid that conflict, Charter specifically stated that to maintain international peace and security, as it is the primary object of the United Nations. And for that purpose, to take effective measures for the prevention and removal of threats to the peace and for the suppression of acts of aggression or other breaches of the peace. Moreover, the Charter specifically stated that settlement of disputes in conformity with principles of justice. If there is conflict in your state, generally, see, as a human being, when we live in the society, we find that there is always conflict between sometimes friends, sometimes with relatives, sometimes with colleagues, sometimes with the local people. So maybe it may be because of the difference of opinion, but there is also a way to settle it. So settlement of dispute is given under the UN Charter, and it should be in conformity with the principle of justice. It should be followed. Again, that principle of justice is different thing. It means different thing for different people. What is justice for me may not be justice for you. What is injustice for you may not be injustice for me. So it's a relative concept. Whenever we approach to the court of law with a petition, we always expect that a particular judge should give decision in my favor. So giving decision in your favor, it is not justice. On the contrary, taking into consideration the evidences and the documents and all of the other things, if the justice is done by that judge, then it is real justice. But we always thought that it should be in my favor. We always thought things should be in my favor. So things, if it is in my favor, it is not just, sometimes maybe it is justice, but always other person is also having some right. So the right of other person also need to be protected, and therefore that charter stated that there should be settlement of dispute between parties through the principle of justice. Next, please. Friends, so far as the UN Charter is concerned, there are very all provisions of UN Charter are very much important, but Article 2 is the principles which are given under Article 2 are very much important. What Article 2 Clause 3 says that all members shall settle. I'm discussing it with you because we are talking about non-violence and to maintain peace. So what Clause 3 says, all members shall settle their international disputes by peaceful means in such a manner that international peace and security and justice are not endangered. So see this beautiful provision that we should settle our dispute through peaceful means only. Thereafter, there is clause 4. It says that all members shall refrain. It is called by the UN to all member states to refrain in their international relations from the threat or use of force. So against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state or in any other manner inconsistent with the purpose of the United Nations. So it is called to the member state not to give any kind of threat or not to use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state, your neighboring state or other state. So we should refrain from using force. If we use force, automatically there will be war. And what UN Charter says, there should not be war. We should be at peace. And what Buddhist principle said, there should always be ahimsa, non-violence. And Buddhism also stated that if there is any conflict, then it should be resolved through peaceful means. So that Article 2.4 is also important. Then the United Nations shall not intervene in matters which are essentially within the domestic jurisdiction of any state. Friends, there is also Clause 7 of Article 2, which is very important. There is prohibition to the states under Clause 4 in respect of refraining from using threat or using force against the other state. But here, there is also provision in Charter which says that UN also should not intervene in the matters which are essentially within the domestic jurisdiction of any state. So if anything is happening in your states, then UN should not intervene in your state because it is your internal matter. Indonesia is a sovereign state, can settle all the matter amicably. Being a sovereign state, we can take decision in India also or in all states. So there should not be unnecessary intervention even from the United Nations to avoid conflict. Then next please. Friends, there is again chapter 6, which provides certain methods for peaceful settlement of international disputes. They include negotiations, good offices, conciliation, judicial settlement, inquiry, or other peaceful means of choice. So under the UN Charter, specific provision have been made for peaceful settlement of international disputes. And if there is conflict, it is for the state to use these methods for settlement of international disputes. So if it is possible to settle through negotiation, use negotiation. If there is need of any good offices from other person, then we can use good offices. Then conciliation. Because if you discuss together, if you come together, then through conciliation, you can settle your matter. Then there is no need of any fighting. Then judicial settlement. There is also a provision you can approach to the International Court of Justice. If there is dispute between two states or more than two states, you can approach to the International Court of Justice. There is no need to fight. That is also forum. But so far as the forum is concerned, only disputant parties can approach to the ICJ for settlement of their dispute, and the inquiry is also used for settlement. Again, Chapter 7 of the UN Charter says that Security Council is empowered to take collective actions against the state which has committed aggression or has otherwise committed a breach of international peace. See, again, to maintain peace and security in the world, important provision is given, power conferred on the Security Council to take collective action against the erring state if that state makes aggression or committed a breach of international peace. So in such circumstances, Security Council can take a decision to suppress that particular act of the erring state. Though in principle, use of force is prohibited by UN Charter, individual and collective self-defense is permissible as an exception as per Article 51. Friends, use of force is prohibited means the primary objective of the UN Charter is to maintain international peace and security. But imagine that there is invasion on your state. Then what to do? At that time, if we are recalling the principles of Buddhism, that what Buddha said, that non-violence or ahimsa. But Buddha also was very much clear about it, that when to do hinsa and when to follow the principle of non-violence. So when one person approached Buddha and asked that we are soldiers and how it is possible for us to follow the principles of Buddhism which says about the non-violence, then Buddha replied that it is your duty as you are soldier, it is your duty to protect your borders, to protect your men. Unnecessarily, there is no need to harm others. But if anyone invades, in such circumstances, to protect your person and property, to guard your people, you can take weapon in your hands. So, there is difference between essential function and ancillary functions. So in essential matters, you can use weapon. And if there is option for you, then try to avoid it. Similarly, UN Charter also allowed individual and collective self-defense. If there is invasion on my state, then, and what UN Charter said about the international peace and security. Buddhism also speaks about non-violence, peace and security. But If anyone invades on your states in such circumstances, it become our duty to protect our person and property, and therefore UN Charter also give this permission for individual and collective self-defense in exceptional circumstances only, as per Article 51. In exceptional circumstances, then once you take such kind of action, then as per provisions of the Charter, it is necessary to inform to the Security Council immediately about your use of force, that there is such and such situation and there was no option but to use the force, and therefore we have used this limited force for our protection, and it should be reported to the United Nations. So these things are given under the Charter. Friends, again, there is important provision in respect of non-violence and ahimsa. See, there is international, there is another branch of international law, that is international humanitarian law or law of armed conflict. These are the set of rules to limit the effects of armed conflict. It is meant for that, to limit the effects of armed conflict. And in that regard, there are four Geneva Conventions of 12th August 1949, and there are two additional protocols of 1977 of 12 August. Now there is one third additional protocols also. This convention provides specific rules to safeguard the combatants or members of the armed forces who are wounded, sick or shipwrecked, prisoners of war and civilians, as well as medical personnel, military chaplains and civil support workers of the military. So through these four Geneva Conventions, it is for armed forces, it is for maritime, it is for your prisoners of war, it is for civilians. Different provisions are given in these four Geneva Conventions. And see, there, in if you read history, you will find that there was a story of King Ashoka. Then he won the war of Kalinga, but he was not happy that time, because one bhikkhu, he approached to him and make realize him that, kindly see the this disaster. And thereafter, that King Ashoka changed his mind, then accept Buddhism, try to follow the Buddhist principle throughout his lifetime. And you all know that he also sent his son and daughter to Sri Lanka with message of Dhamma. Similarly, in modern era, he is not like great like King Ashoka, but he is also important person, Henry Dunant. So when he saw the disaster in battlefield in Italy, then he come up with idea that there is need to help the wounded, sick and such persons who are affected by the armed conflict, and therefore decided to establish one organization, and later we found that resulted into International Committee of the Red Cross. In these four Geneva Convention, there is common Article 3. What this common Article 3 stated, that those who are
Sorry, Professor, I would like to remind you that your time remaining is 5 minutes before we
Okay, sir, I will.
Right.
Yes, that common Article 3 is very much important, which says speaks about providing help to the all military persons, those who are wounded and sick. Then how we can correlate this Article 3, common Article 3, with Buddhist teaching? So Buddhism speaks for compassion, to see enemy as human being, minimize suffering, then use of deadly force to avoid collateral death, injury to non-combatant. We never want any harm to the persons. Similarly, what we discuss in Eightfold Path, that there is right livelihood, means samma ajiva. So any person who is following Buddhism, he will not involve himself into trade of weapons, specifically prohibited, the arms which are prohibited. Moreover, care for injured, then abstain from sexual misconduct. These are given in 5 precepts: protection of civilian property, prohibition of stealing during armed conflict, and environment protections. So all these things are given under 5 precepts in Buddhism and other places also. Friends, again, there is an important provision in respect of arbitration. It is also an important humanistic principle that if there is conflict, then try to settle that particular dispute through arbitration. And there is also a story in respect of Shakya and Kolya, and wherein Buddha stated that Shakya and Kolya, instead of fighting or waging war, instead of that, appoint 2 persons from Shakya, appoint 2 persons from Kolya, and these 4 persons will appoint 5th person, and that particular group of people will decide that matter, what that system we call as arbitration. It was supported by Buddha even before enlightenment, when he was Prince Gautama. There is also provision in respect of settlement of dispute, and as per Article 33 of the UN Charter, and there is also unsettled model law in respect of commercial matters. So instead of going to detail, I would like to conclude that according to Buddha, morality is the Dhamma, and Dhamma is morality. Hence, humanitarian values need to be upheld. Buddha gave importance to karma and said, "Reap as you sow." So we should concentrate on our good karma. Or the Dhamma. On the social, political, and economic fronts, Buddha's humanitarian teachings are equally important in the contemporary era also. Buddha's teachings is all about social justice, equality, fraternity, compassion, and ahimsa. Buddha's teachings are important to maintain peace and harmony in the society. And there are some suggestions to that, to follow the Buddha Dhamma Sangha and Eightfold Path of. With this, I would like to conclude. If you want to ask anything, thank you very much, Dr. Edi, for providing me this opportunity to share my views on the humanistic views in Buddhism and its relevance under contemporary international law. So, taking into consideration the time limit, I have concluded my talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sandeep Nagarale from Amolachan Law of College, Yavtamal Mahasrastha College, India. Well, for me, after listening your presentations, now I understand, because my background is not in law, but my background in linguistics. Yes. Now I understand that every legal formal constitution managed by international association like UN, Geneva Convention, including IHL, International Humanitarian Law, were based on the principle of Buddhism. Like you mentioned ago, that when Buddha talks about equality of men and women are equally dignity, and also some principles like liberty of ahimsa and nonviolence and so on and so forth are the fundamentals of why in today's world, we can see the legal formal of international law were based mainly from Buddhism views on humanistic and the values of the humanistic itself. Well, it is very clear for us right now, for those who are not learning law in the formal education, and as a Buddhist, at most, we can understand that there are some features, principles on Buddhist teaching adopted by international law that we can see today as UN Charter, IHL, and so on and so forth. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Sandeep is an Indian scholar. So you can ask your question, you can raise question also in the Indian context. Let me translate a little bit in Bahasa Indonesia, Professor Sandeep.
Yes, sir, yes, no problem.
Jadi tadi berbicara soal kasta di India, berbicara soal bagaimana prinsip ahimsa itu dilakukan di India, banyak didasarkan dari aspek-aspek Buddhism yang ada di India. So, now it's time for Q&A session. Pertanyaan bisa ditulis di chat box, atau bisa diambil dari YouTube. atau bisa langsung raise hand, kemudian kalau bisa menyampaikan langsung dalam bahasa Inggris itu akan jauh lebih bagus. So you can ask questions by writing in the chat box, or if you are viewing us on YouTube channel of STABN Sriwijaya, you can text the questions in the comments box, and then the staff will pass it to me, and I will pass it again to the speaker. Or if it is can be delivered in English directly, it will be much better. So a question and answer, a Q&A session is open right now. Please ask question. Thank you. Silakan yang ingin bertanya. Bapak Ibu yang ada di Zoom or anyone attended in the Zoom meeting, you can raise questions. Hello? Mas Awal, apakah ada pertanyaan dari kanal YouTube? If you can Mas Awal, adakah pertanyaan dari kanal YouTube? Atau silakan saya buka sesi pertanyaannya. Oke. Profesor San, can you little bit explore about the caste system in India? How is it going right now? Like and how Buddhist values affects the caste system atau sistem kasta, the caste system in India. Can you give us more updates about the situation of the caste system in India right now,
Professor? Caste system means you're talking about the judicial matters, right?
Yes, like the term Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya.
Okay, Sudha, yes. Caste system. Oh, sorry. Caste system. In India, we since Vedic period, there were four Varnas. Brahmana, then Kshatriya, Vaishya, and the Kshudra. Brahmana were considered as the intellectuals of the society and only allowed, according to them only, according to Brahmana, they are the representative of God on this earth, and therefore they have only right to read and talk about the religion, and no one else can talk about the religion. And so you will find that these people are priests in a number of temples. Second one is Kshatriya. According to old that practice followed, these people were allowed or empowered to do one function only, that is to protect the borders, means sipai. That was second category. Third was the Vaishya, and their work was to do the business. No other person was allowed to do business except that Vaishya. And fourth category was about the Shudra, fourth Varna. That it is prevalent at that time that it was duty that time to serve all these three Varna. And there was also another class, that is Atishudra, that was also considered as you can say slave. Even they were untouchables. These Varna from three peoples, three categories from these three Varna, even they were hesitant to touch this fourth Varna. That much discrimination was in existence at that time. And therefore, considering that practice, evil practice, that how can, when we are human beings, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights, then how can a particular person only read and write books, or particular person can become a priest, or only few are allowed to protect the borders, or only few are allowed to do the business? So Buddha prescribed for this equality, he treat all people with equality. At that time also, he gave entry in his Sangha to these peoples, those who were considered as untouchables according to the old system. But even though the system was prevalent at that time, you will find it is continued. Even though Buddha tried his level best to maintain equality among people and in the society, and that much there was also good result in the society, but later on again some changes took place, and again the old system followed by few people, you can say till independence of the nation India in 1947. Now also on paper we have these principles, equality, fraternity, justice, but up to some extent in remote areas there is also discrimination. This is reality, but it is not the fact that there is complete discrimination. On the contrary, the Constitution of India protects rights of every Indian citizen. Fundamental rights are given to the citizens, and if there is any violation of the rights of people, they can approach to the court of law and ask for justice.
Thank you for the updates, Professor Sandeep. We have one question from the chat box.
Yes, sir.
There is a term, death sentence, or the death for giving punishment, the punishment of death, in yes. our legal system. In every state, it exists.
Yes.
What is your own point of view, and how Buddhists see this death sentence in terms of law?
Okay. So, as Buddhism speaks about the compassion, fraternity, brotherhood. But suppose there is a criminal, and that criminal is dangerous to society. In such circumstances, if we talk about present-day legal system, that person, we used to put him behind the bars in prison. If he has committed heinous crime, then for such heinous crimes like murders or rapes and such offenses, there are punishment like lifetime imprisonment. And in only exceptional cases, here is provision of death penalty. So in India, our law is also speak about the death penalty, but not in all cases. Only the Honorable Apex Court of India evolved a theory that only in exceptional cases only this death penalty should be given to the criminal. Otherwise, you can give other punishment like life imprisonment to that person. So in exceptional, rarest of rare case only, that death penalty should be given. And it is in also in accordance with the international international convention that it should be abolished. Though we are a signatory of other conventions, but in India we have not signed that particular convention which prohibit death penalty completely. So far as Buddhism is concerned, according to me, there is principle of compassion, love. So, but at the same time, there is also need to give punishment for that. You can change his mind by but we can say enlightening his mind. But at the same time, there is also need to give punishment to the hardcore criminals. And therefore, that hinsa was not denied totally by Buddha. Even his time. So in essential conditions that killing is permissible, this is my view. Maybe you may differ.
Okay, thank you. At least we can hear your point of view on the issues of giving death penalties to exceptional cases, and it is very rare conducted, yeah, because we know that the criminals need to be fought, and at the same time Buddhists also talk about compassion, yeah, so that's why we need to see in the both sides. Okay,
actually in number of legal systems different theories are being followed in respect of punishment. So there is also one theory, that is deterrent theory. If you create deterrent effect in the minds of criminals by giving punishment, then other criminals, they will take lesson from it. So if you punish one person, other criminals, they will not dare to do such kind of heinous act.
Okay. Thank you. Pak Bambang Utoyo, do you have any questions or comments? Pak Bambang Utoyo, do you have any question or comments or clarification? Okay. Thank you, Professor Sandeep. I think our time is up. Thank you very much for completing our request to be a guest speaker in our special lecture.
Edi, sebentar, ada pertanyaan tapi salah masuk kamar.
Oke.
Okay. Salah masuk ke saya. Ini dari Bapak Sugianto. Apa pengaruh dari pemikiran Ambedkar pada eksistensi Buddhisme di India saat ini? Peran apa saja yang dilakukan oleh pengikut Buddha di India dalam menjaga perdamaian di masa sekarang?
Thank you. Sorry, Professor Sandeep, we have another incoming question from participant.
Yes, please.
Still, okay. The question is about the roles of central iconic scholar named Dr. Ambedkar.
Yes.
In accordance with his presence as the Buddhist scholars, what yes. are the models and what sort of best practice that he made in terms of preserving peace and also harmony, and what have been adopted by Buddhist civilization and also maybe most of the Indians in terms of keeping peace based on Dr. Ambedkar's views and movements nowadays?
Yes. So, as I already said, that Dr. Ambedkar is the person who is instrumental in reviving Buddhism in India. So in 1956, he embraces Buddhism with 5 lakh people at a time. So without doing any harm, any bloodshed, he succeeded to give that Buddha Dhamma at a time to 5 lakh people along with him. And that was a historical event in the history of India. Moreover, he was one of the member of Constituent Assembly, chairman of the drafting committee also. And he tried to imbibe the Buddhist philosophy into Indian constitution. In his last speech in Constituent Assembly, he also stated that while drafting this constitution, as we have inserted these principles of equality, liberty, fraternity, justice, these principles, these are not taken from the French Revolution or any other state or from any other ideology, but these are the ideals which were given by Buddha in his time. So nothing new is given by Constituent Assembly to the people of India. These were the same principles which were given by Buddha at his time. So we'll find reflection of Buddhist thought, Buddhist philosophy, humanistic views in Indian constitution. And moreover, the rule of law, that is important. And the constitution of India protects rights of all these peoples. So far as the Ambedkarite movement in India is concerned, basically these people, now these people are realizing that basically they were belong to the Buddhism. And now they are reading books. Now they are interacting with people from other states. And now the literature is available. So they realize, people of India is realizing that their ancestors were real Buddhist. But in meantime, they were shifted from Buddhism to other places. So now that also create great impact on the minds of people. And in entire India, there is a movement, Ambedkarite movement. And these people always fight for the constitutional right, human right, and Buddhist right. So basically, the protection of rights is the main weapon, you can say, or their ideology to protect the rights of people. It doesn't matter that the right of a particular person violated here only, even though at any other place, in any other province, any other state, rights of people are being violated by the hands of state. Then Ambedkarite people used to come forward and try to give justice to the victims. So Ambedkarite movement is doing well in India. And also it spread in many countries. Taking into consideration the contribution of Dr. Ambedkar, that Zeniath Elliott from USA and other philosophers from Japan, Germany, now they are reading the Ambedkarite literature and Buddhist literature. And even countries like Hungary, they have started the Ambedkar school because they realize that these are the rights given to the people by Dr. Ambedkar. And why Dr. Ambedkar prescribed for these rights of people? Because he was influenced by Buddha, and Buddha always stand for humanistic views or humanistic principles.
Thank you very much, Professor Sandeep, for your responses. So I forgot to mention the two names of the one who raised the question are from Sri Wahyuni and Sugianto. Both are coming from our college, Sriwijaya. So thank you for your questions. Ladies and gentlemen, my dear participants, I think the time split us very, very fast. And I would like to present one of the conclusions is that the legal system that has been adopted by both international institution and also states where the respect for humanity must be seen as universal values, which also can be come from Buddhist teaching that we call as a principle of equality. Men and women are equally dignity equal, and also the principles of ahimsa or nonviolence. We have heard a lot of good things and insights from Professor Sandeep Nagarale, and he is one of the experts in law and how it is related with the existence of Buddhistic views and other principles of Buddhist teaching. So we are very honored to have his presentation in our SACC program. And we hope that at another time, we can invite you directly face-to-face, Professor, after this all pandemic situation over, we may can arrange some conferences. And please be ready for our invitation.
Thank you very much for this honor.
Okay, baik, untuk informasi selanjutnya, SACC akan mengadakan webinar, bukan webinar, special lecture dan special talk dari berbagai macam pembicara dari berbagai macam negara. Bapak Ibu yang ingin menginginkan sertifikat secara online, panitia telah menyediakan link untuk diisi setelah mengisi lembar evaluasi atau halaman evaluasi untuk penyelenggaraan webinar ini. So for those who may want to have their e-certificate online, would you please go check your chat box in this Zoom, and then you will be directed to the evaluation form, and then please fill your name and the email required. The e-certificate will be sent directly to your email addresses. Thank you for your presence today. And before we disembark, would you please Pak Waluyo untuk menyampaikan program SACC pada tanggal 14. Silakan Pak Waluyo.
Ya, nanti pada tanggal 14 kami juga akan mengadakan acara serupa dengan narasumber yang berbeda. Jadi mohon partisipasinya kembali, ikutilah acara ini. Ini baru tahap, ini adalah yang pertama, akan menyusul narasumber-narasumber berikutnya dari berbagai negara. Gitu ya, Mister ya.
Ya, terima kasih. Thank you Pak Waluyo for reminding us. So before we leave, let's now take a virtual Wi-Fi ya, together on the screen. Professor Sandeep, would you please make your camera on? We will take a picture and it will be uploaded in our social media. Semuanya juga ya, yang lain bisa menghidupkan on cam. Jadi nanti organizer bisa mengambil gambar. Silakan Pak Waluyo.
Iya, sambil saya mengambil gambar foto Bapak-Ibu juga bisa mengambil gambarnya untuk dijadikan status media sosial, kemudian tag media sosial kami, STABN Sriwijaya. Ada 5 slide, sebentar ya. Yang pertama, yang kedua, ya boleh ditahan senyumnya karena ada 5 slide ya.
Keep smile.
Yang ketiga,
the third slide, because we have 130 participants.
Yang keempat, ya.
Now the fourth. Hold on your camera.
Terakhir yang kelima.
The last one. This is the fifth slide.
Okay, sudah. Terima kasih.
Right. Thank you very much, everybody. May the COVID-19 will fastly gone from this world. Let's spread our prayers and best for our world, so we will get recovered very soon and we will go back normal as usual. Thank you for your presence, and for Professor Sandeep Negarali, I would like to ask Pak Sapardi as Chairman of Stabilan Sriwijaya to say thank you. Pak Sapardi, time is yours, please. In Bahasa Indonesia, I'll translate to English.
Ya, selamat sore, Namo Buddhaya.
Thank you very much.
Terima kasih, Prof. Sandeep.
Thank you, Professor Sandeep.
Atensi yang sudah kami dengarkan, ya. Semoga membawa berkah bagi perkembangan agama Buddha di Indonesia. Mohon selanjutnya nanti berkenan untuk menjadi dosen di Sriwijaya, ya, Mr. Reddy, ya.
We would like to invite you as visiting lecturers for Sriwijaya State Buddhist College of Tangerang, Banten.
Sekali lagi terima kasih, thank you very much.
Once again, namaskar and namaste from Indonesia for Professor Sandeep Negarali in India. Thank you very much. Thank you everyone. Everyone may leave and see you. Namo Buddhaya. Virtual applause dong untuk Professor Sandeep.
Namo Buddhaya. Thank you, Mr. Sandeep.
Terima kasih.
Thank you, Professor Sandeep. You may leave the Zoom. Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll send the certificate to your email.
Okay.
Thank you everybody. We will have Dr. Lydia Brown in the fourth Juli akan ada presentasi dari Profesor Lydia Brown dari Melbourne University dari Australia pada tanggal 14. Waktu dan venue-nya akan diumumkan oleh panitia di media sosial Stabban Sriwijaya. Terima kasih, sampai bertemu di SACC berikutnya.
Terima kasih, Mr. Edi.
Selamat dan sukses ya kepada Mr. Edi.
Terima kasih.
Terima kasih.